So one of the more interesting things happening in Europe policy-wise lately was the Icelandic Modern Media Initiative. And I hope you all know that this talk is about it. Daniel Donfriedberg about exactly that topic. Thank you.
Hi. Before I begin talking about, as has been announced, the Icelandic Modern Media Initiative, I'd at least like to make a short disclaimer to put the whole thing into a bit of a context. So I'm on the stage today because actually the people that would have held that talk did not arrive here. So Birgitta Jonstad here, a parliamentarian from Iceland, was actually supposed to hold this talk. She, for a couple of reasons, could not come. Then Smari McCarthy, someone else who is very actively working in Iceland on this initiative, could not come either. So now I'm in a position that, as I had been involved in the past, I'm talking to you about this subject. On the other hand, I can't really go on the stage and just talk about the Icelandic Modern Media Initiative without maybe at least tackling a couple of other topics that some people are asking me about all the time. So it's very important for me to make clear that these are different subjects, but they have some common grounds, and maybe that is how I can justify talking about both of them and hopefully being able to put them in a bit of a context. So I've struggled very hard to compile what actually it is that I would want to talk about, because I feel this year, as Rob has been highlighting in the keynote too, it's a very important year. Lots of things are happening at the moment, and it's not entirely clear where we are all heading, as Rob had this very nice analogy with a bus that we're all sitting in. But on the other hand, I feel that we should try to define a bit more of that bus. So I had been involved in IMI quite right at the beginning. We were in Iceland talking about the possibilities to do that. And when about 1 year ago to the day, I entered this stage under a pseudonym, Daniel Schmidt, that I was working under, I was basically as proud as a man can be, I guess. At least that's how it felt. I was in company of a man that I thought was a true companion, that was together with me working on shared ideals that we both had, and that I had joined for what we both thought would be an important pursuit. And if you look at recent events, I guess that it would that's what it has become. It has become a very important pursuit of an ideal. We both were in this pursuit already knee-deep for quite a while, and we had gotten pretty optimistic about how things were developing. In fact, the outcome of all of that pursuit of trying to ensure some of the freedoms that we all have in society and maybe enhancing these freedoms had never looked as promising as in the last year when we were here. If you listened to Rob's keynote again, and maybe even his talk on We Lost the War a few years ago, it felt a bit like we had gotten a bit ahead of the curve. So I felt that I almost wanted to say that Rob was wrong, and Rob and Frank actually talking about it, and that we got ahead of the curve and we were finally getting on top of things again, because it was all looking so promising. So at the last 26 C3, we had just come from Iceland, where we had met other people that shared the same ideals as we did, and we had proposed an avenue that only few fiction authors had so far dared to dream about. Neal Stephenson had described it in the Cryptonomicon, for example. A world that had a place that would value the free flow of information just as it's valuing its other currencies that it has. A world that understood about the value of that currency, of that information, for all of our future, and that would decide to protect these values just as aggressively as it is protecting other assets. When we told you about all of that last year at the Congress here, and some of those that might have been here might remember it, it was congratulated with a tremendous applause. And I think, at least within the Congresses that I have witnessed this, it was one of the best applauses that there had been, and it just felt that what we were doing was worthwhile and we were heading somewhere that everyone could perceive as a common goal. So all of that made us very, very optimistic when we started into the new year. In the months after the Congress, we helped to make this project in Iceland a reality. We worked on it for the better of 1 month, sort of nonstop, and with the help of many others, from Birgitta Jonstad here in the Parliament to Rob Gongrip here, Frank Riegel or Jacob Applebaum, and a lot of other people that you probably will never hear about anyways. All these people have put in a lot of work into that project, and they set something in motion. If Smari or Birgitta were here today, they would have told you that IMI has in the last few months matured pretty well. It is actually establishing itself. It is spread over different ministries that are working on different angles of it, different political parties, cross-party support is it has received, and it's actually also looking very good. So just to recap pretty shortly, what is actually IMI? IMI is supposed to be, or is developing a legal and regulatory framework that aims at establishing a soundly defined legal framework for publishers on the internet. So in that context, part of it is to create a global safe haven for investigative journalism and for critical information. The first country that has a set of regulations fit for our future societies. IMI was worked on heavily in the first half of 2010, and on the 16th of June, it unanonymously passed through its first parliamentary vote. The IMI proposal instructed the government by that vote, among a few other things, that a legal framework for media and free speech protections should be worked out, that it should be researched, that other laws from other countries should be looked into and taken into account, and that Iceland in general should receive a general review of its information and infrastructure security, and other similar activities around that. So all of this aiming at creating a first end-to-end framework on a legal ground for the internet and information and the means of communication for us. The Ministry of Education is working on that proposal since then, and the Ministry of Education has a duty to inform Parliament about the progress every 3 months. Despite that such a notice has yet to happen, there still is good progress. A new media law, which had been in creation back when we were in Iceland, has been modified to contain better protections for journalist sources and is already the first law that is hopefully going to be implemented soon that is containing part of what IMI will be. So that bill particularly will be hopefully tabled in January or February. So it is quite about 1 year after things started to happen, the first actual regulations will come on the table. Most of the other work is research, as I mentioned before. So one of the things that we all learned the hard way during that year is that if you want to do something correctly, it tends to require some time. So while setting IMI into motion was quite easy, as at least it felt, because it's a small country and we could easily reach a lot of politicians and people that had an interest in advancing this, from businesses to telco providers, regulatory authorities, all the people that we talked to in Iceland, they understood why this would make sense and why it would give them some stability and would give them a good perspective for the future. So all of that was set in motion pretty easily, but I guess then meeting with regulations we have or processes within parliaments, and when it just starts to take some time. So whatever you do, it will require some time, even if it's such a small place as Iceland. IMI has also spawned a couple of follow-up initiatives, that's something I'd like to mention as well, in other countries, like Italy, Spain, and Slovenia. So all of these countries are looking into seeing how much they can adapt parts of the IMI proposal for their countries, and that's actually really Italy. So I was a bit astonished to hear that. They still have some way to go, I guess, in respect to press freedoms, but at least it seems like some people are beginning. And that, I guess, is a good sign. So there are a lot of things that are happening that I think should make us confident in the fact that something has been set forth. But what does all of that mean? So first of all, I think these are good news, and we can see that something has been set in motion, and it is inspiring some kind of reform. On the other hand, personally, I think that just the last few months have shown all of us why something like this and a bold approach like IMI might present has become ever important. If we look at recent events, and mainly these events are caused by the latest world record publications made by WikiLeaks in form of the diplomatic cables recently, we can see pretty plainly how fragile the fundament of free communication for all of our future is. So we should understand why an initiative, even if it's small and it's just tangling Iceland, why has become ever important in ensuring our freedoms and showing that there's an alternative path we can go. And I'd like to make perfectly clear what the freedom of communication is that I'm trying to get at here. So abstractly, I guess, our society is right now transforming into its next evolutionary stage. So we are approaching the age of a globalized society that we have all been told about for decades. A world where all the decisions that we take day to day have to be seen in a global context, where whether those are plain consumer decisions that we take or it being decisions on the freedom of the tools to communicate that we have. And especially the freedoms to use these tools, who can use it, and the frameworks we define for that usage and for these tools. So the tool of communication in the future that we have is the internet. There's no doubt about this, and I guess I don't have to really explain that to anyone here anyways, but maybe we need to be more aware of this issue. So that wonderful interconnecting technology that we have has brought us all very closely together, close to one another. It is the fundamental tool underlying all of our communication needs in the present and especially in the future. So the internet will be as crucial to all our future liberties, our possibilities to talk to each other, as has been the printing of books for the enlightenment of humankind. And it is a tool of the future, but it is stuck in the present. And that's what we have to understand. As a tool, the internet enables our communication capabilities to be scaled to future needs. But its use, and that is also nothing new, leads to an immense challenge of structures of our society, of powers that exist, and it leads to the need for a redefinition of these terms on which we communicate, on which we interact, and all of these things. And the existing structures fight back, and that's what we can perceive in various forms over the last few years or even months. So in the last years, there have been numerous advances in this field. Censorship lists, Hadoopy, data retention, or just outrageous ideas like creating opening hours for the German internets. We've all been challenged, and I mean really challenged, with ideas that sound so barely real, and that at some point in time even sound so ridiculous that you can hardly take them seriously. But all of these efforts, nevertheless, they aim at something very common, and that is the aim of restricting the reformatory power of the tools that we have in these days to define our future. So countering those advances alone kept a lot of organizations busy in the last years. So you can look at the CCC or the folks from the Föbot or AK-Zensur, La Quadrature in France, or the ADRI on the European level. There are plenty of organizations that are all maxed out by taking care of defending some of our rights. And if there's any lesson we can learn from that, and that is an important lesson I learned when observing all of this, is that what we need is not one organization or one leader or whatever that is traveling into one direction, but what we actually need is a strong, diverse, and decentralized community of different organizations, of capable individuals that act up in the community, and unified in the acting on a free future's behalf. So, feel like I'm not really getting anywhere, so I hope. Similarly, on another level, we are seeing advances on other tools that we have. So it's not just the internet as the fundament that is being attacked, but it's also applications on that internet, whatever it is. So they can come in the shape of financial locusts at MasterCard or PayPal, or those centralizing the provisioning of information like Amazon and other providers that deny services due to political pressure or personal disliking. Our tools have become an object of politics, and they need future users to defend them. And for that, we need their future users to understand why they are so important. If the incident with Amazon discontinuing its cloud-based hosting services to WikiLeaks has proven one important thing, then it is that a cloud is completely useless if you can dissolve it with one shot from a weather cannon. And if that's what cloud computing is about, if that's what centralizing information in one place just because it scales so well or whatever, if that's what it's about, then we need to get rid of these concepts as soon as possible because they don't lead anywhere good for us. So the same goes for financial services. If political pressure or preference can mean that the denial of services to the free society, then we have a serious problem, and we should probably get rid of these concepts also and move on to alternatives. I mean, Peter is unfortunately not here this year, but in case anyone hasn't heard of Flutter yet, that's an alternative, I guess. Or you can just go completely anonymous and buy PaySafe cards or Ucash or use whatever other method to transfer funds on the internet. You don't need to rely on any of these services that do not behave in a way that we can tolerate it as a free society. All that requires is a choice, and that choice again needs to be spawned from people that are well informed, that look at things critically, that ask questions, and that do not just follow what someone is telling them is the right thing to do. So for the sake of the future, we need to defend from all of these attacks. If we do not do that, this means that we are at the end of a beginning, and that's the beginning of an end, and I think that's not where we want to head. The beginning of that end, as I had, the beginning of that defense that we need to see, and that's basically what I'm trying to aim at overall, is that we all have to start understanding problems. A few months ago, I realized that despite all the motivation that I had put into the WikiLeaks project, and despite all the belief I had that this was the ultimate thing I could involve in, at some point in time, we identified that there are problems, and there are problems that if you do not resolve them, they start corrupting the ideals of your organization and the principles by which you started out at some point in time. So there are always multiple answers to questions, and it's possibly it's impossible to predict what is the right answer. But that process of critically thinking about things, of starting to doubt, and using that doubt, that critical thinking to get more of a perspective. That is what led me and other individuals to leave that organization, just because we thought there was no more common ground to work on. I guess most of you that are working in open source projects should be pretty familiar with that process. It's called a fork, and that's what happens if people that work on a common goal do not share the same idea of how to get to that goal at some point in time. And then your ways divert, and the only thing that can happen is that there's more diversity in, I don't know if you want to call that a market, but that there's more diversity in one area, and that diversity will only lead to strengthen it. Same as we have seen with the defense of our freedoms on the internet. We need diversity, we need decentralism, and we need individuals and individual organizations to collaborate on certain matters that are in our interest. So, so I can't really tell. The time is running out way more slow than is that clock actually accurate, or I'm at the end of what I had written down in an effort to try to to talk about some of these matters here this year, and I think there are still a lot of open questions. I've desperately tried to avoid getting too concrete about the new project that we are working on, just because we need some more time. We need some more time to put up a website that will explain to all of you what it is that we are working on. And I thought that putting some of the more general problems that we have in a society in context are a bit more important. I'm not sure if that clock is really accurate. If it is, we still have 53 minutes left for questions. I guess that's... that's a bit of a self-defeat. If you have any questions, if you want to discuss that with me, I'm more than happy to elaborate a bit more on what I was trying to aim at in what I feel was more confusing talk than anything else. But in any way, thanks for the attention so far. And
thank you. So, questions. Audio?
Could you please elaborate a bit about the current situation in Iceland and what is your roadmap? What do you intend to do to build at least one country with kind of a decent Netzpolitik?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so did everyone get the question? I'm, as I said before, I'm not actively involved anymore in the IMI initiative, just because I'm caught up in a lot of other work. So that's partly also, I guess, why I didn't even finish to write up a decent speech, just because I'm kept up with a lot of stuff even here on this conference that used to be sort of my living room in between the New Year's, which sort of has become so packed with press and everyone caught in the buzz that... it's just hard to focus on things. So there are other people working on IMI, capable people. I mentioned a couple of names before. And the current strategy is to work with all the ministries, the parties that are involved in implementing the different angles of that proposal into Icelandic law. So as I said, there's one, the whole source protection angle, which will hopefully become reality pretty soon. Especially because it could be attached to a existing reform in the media law section, so that made it a bit easier. On the other hand, there are other initiatives that are going on. So I can't really tell you about the timeline there, but on imi.is you can find out more info. So I'm really sorry that I'm. Can't give you any more current detail. So I've tried to cover that as good as I could, but that's about all I know myself for now.
Question? Yes. I think there is a certain barrier from the... I think there's a certain barrier from diversity, profiting from diversity, which is called language, and that seems to play a role in IMI especially. So at least I made the experience that you don't get too much information in English or German about IMI. And is there any project you know about to transfer or to translate these projects and what has been done in Iceland to English or German? And with the aim, perhaps not only to let Italy lead and protect media owners in Italy, which might be some interest there, but to have a media initiative like in Iceland as well here in Germany.
Okay, so that's actually a very important question, because it brings me to one important point that I didn't make, which is that, you see, IMI, as a lot of other alternatives, initiatives that are being run today, doesn't have any funding, and it doesn't have anyone that can take care of it exclusively. And in that respect, it is a project of lots of individuals that are acting up, that have a shared interest in pursuing that ideal. But part of what you've been saying, and that's the language barrier, just cannot be addressed because there's plainly not enough resources to take care of all that stuff. And in the same way, there would be a tremendous need for more lawyers involving. I don't know, maybe I can get Tiffany to in touch there. She's actually, that's something I should mention too. There's going to be a talk about data havens here tomorrow. So you should probably go see that talk because it will also cover IMI a bit, I think. And it will deal with all sorts of other engagements that we have worldwide where angles like that should be considered. And so, but in any way, that is what we need more. There need to be more lawyers, more people that can contribute to that whole idea, to translate it into other languages, to bring it to other parts of the world. And so if I can ask anyone here that has an interest to promote IMI or to help out there, the people are certainly nice to work with, and whoever has some time on his hands is certainly welcome too.
Okay, this may be not directly related, but the medial narrative of technical organizations like WikiLeaks or Wikipedia or OpenBSD is often dominated by single persons that play the hero or villain role, and this, I think, makes them, well, in one sense more powerful, but also more vulnerable. Do you think this is a good thing, and do you think there is a way to overcome this to be more effective in the political process?
Okay, well, that goes pretty much to the heart of the problem, I guess. So I think generally what the future needs, and that's what I try to get at too, and I think I didn't even bring it across, what the future needs is not one leader, but more like a world that is made out of leaders, where everyone is in a position that he's educated well enough, that he's walking upright enough, all these things, so he could be a leader. So I think that has to be decentralized too. That's a problem that we see.
It's more about the narrative, like not, I mean,
well, that's, yeah, but I
Wikipedia
mean, that's,
is it, a big community, and still people always talk about Jimbo Wales.
Yes. Well, no, they're not, actually. They talk about Jimbo Wales. No, they talk about him when there's his picture and it's asking for donations. Okay, that was working on multiple levels, I think. But that's what, you see, that's what, it's good, you need faces, you know. You need people that have, you can talk to. That's why people want to talk to me at this conference, and that's good, because that's how intercourse and exchange works, you know, like people talking to each other and exchanging their views, and it's very important to have that, that's what the press wants, and that's where I agree with the narrative. They always want to promote one person that is a leader. They always want to have someone that has maximum credibility or maximum a maximum position in some way. They want to talk to someone they can call the founder or the speaker or I don't know what. So that is a problem with a narrative. And the only way to change that is by the society getting disinterested in this approach. So I think it can only be worked around or changed if we all realize that narrative is not leading anywhere. And that basically this is probably what has killed all revolutions we had in the past, where something tremendously large could have changed in society and how we see things, but it did not change just because we kept going back to the same principles of outsourcing responsibility to one person or one organization or whatever in that respect.
So you think we should all be responsible for ourselves?
Sorry?
So you want to say that we should all say that we are responsible for ourselves, and that should be the narrative.
Yes. Yeah, no, that's what, I mean, this is what all it is about. All of you here, and I said that last year and the year before too, there's a tremendous potential that is in this room, just by the skills of people here, and you're all individually responsible for using that skill responsibly and in a way that it is good for society and not just for your own benefit. I mean, that's a choice you have, but I think it works out better if we all work together. So, and that's an individual choice that has to be taken. That's no one that can dictate this on you, or not a leader that can tell you that this is what you should do. That's something you have to come to yourself as your own conclusion.
Thank you.
At the moment, there are a bunch of websites who claim that WikiLeaks somehow cooperates with the Israeli government. Uh-huh. And one of those cites you as a source. So I would like to have publicly from you what that you haven't said anything in that regard or...
Yeah, thanks a lot. That's my favorite topic in the last few weeks. So, okay, that brings me back to one of the other points that I wanted to hit on before, and I think I missed. So the claim is, I'm not sure if everyone heard it, the claim is that I allegedly had talked to I think Israeli reporter, alleging that there was a deal made between WikiLeaks and secret intelligence in Israel, or some semi-officials, or however it was called, and it's been spread over various forums, especially in Russia, and it has now reached some mainstream press, and I'm getting calls from France and from Scandinavia if I had made these allegations. So this is a perfect example of disinformation that we see spreading today, and this is another example why we all have to look very closely. So I have never been in touch with any reporter. Actually, I couldn't even find that reporter anywhere. She doesn't seem to exist. And it's just distracting all of us from the real content that is there. And that's the same thing with fake diplomatic cables that come up somewhere that allege stuff. And it's the same thing with, I don't know, lots of different legal issues being thrown into one large pot, and we don't even know what it exactly is that we are defending us from, or who it is that we're defending from what. And it's all adding up to the confusion. So I think what we're seeing is the beginning of the first real war on information. And that, again, in this community should be pretty, we should all be pretty aware of this, because we're probably one of the few groups on the world that can understand that war, because we technically understand it. So I'm not entirely sure what comes out of that, but I hope that it all is going to be resolved, because we're all critically looking at the facts. So.
Hi, I have one question out of the chat.
Yes.
Anonymous, you. Would Imi be interested in crowdsourcing translations?
Yeah, absolutely. I can't imagine that anyone would have anything against that. The website is imi.is. There are contacts, contact addresses, and send an email, and they'll involve you.
Thanks.
Hi. Can you tell us something specific about the structure of OpenLeaks and how hopefully it'll be less vulnerable than WikiLeaks?
Okay. There have been a couple of newspaper stories about this topic anyways. So, if you look at what WikiLeaks is, or the whole concept of whistleblowing, technical solutions for whistleblowing right now, is that there is one input stream where you can send a document or thousands of documents, and it ends up in an organization, and there it is being processed, it is being verified, maybe it's being worked on, it's analyzed, summaries are written, it has to be anonymized, all these things, and then there is one stream where it can be output. So, and all in between the input and the output is one blob that is actually a real blob, because it's not transparent at this point in time, that is doing whatever it does. And the more successful that concept gets, and I guess we all can see that it is very successful, the more workload is created, and that means that you're running into bottlenecks. That's just a mere scalability issue. And the solution to that is to decentralize that whole structure, to make sure that you can address resource constraints more efficiently. So what OpenLeaks will be about is making sure that there are hundreds of sites that have input streams and enabling these sites to decide how they want to output material. That is basically the approach that we are aiming at. So I think WikiLeaks was very important to show that there's a need for such technology, for such sites, and it has spawned a cultural debate that was very, very important. We are discussing today, I mean, even my grandfather in the 8 o'clock news is confronted with the problem of secrecy in today's world, and what must be secret and what must not be secret. And that is, these are two things, very important things that we need to redefine for the future, because they just don't fit into this bus that we are driving as they are right now. So, so decentralizing that whole operation, I think, is what will help to make it more democratic, to make it more stable against attack, to make it more sustainable, and in some way to make sure that the power that accumulates also is distributed over more shoulders than just one pair of shoulders.
Thank you.
Yeah, one more question out of the chat. Alex asks, forks are important sometimes, but isn't it a little bit early this time? Don't you think that WikiLeaks is young enough to be changed in the direction the community prefers? At least it's still a developing concept.
That's what we thought for a couple of months. I mean, I can only say that. It was not a quick decision for anyone to take. It is not a early decision to fork off that project.
This is the third time I have seen you on the stage, and I honestly missed the standing ovation. Simply thank you, Daniel, for all you've done.
No. Just one short comment, just quickly. This year, this is all right, just because there have been many more people, especially within the last few months, that have been doing way more work than I could do, just because I've been constantly on the run, trying to do something productive and not being held up all the time. So it's other people that deserve this credit. I'm just standing here on their behalf. So I just wanted to have...
I have a really general question about the whole concept of such organizations as WikiLeaks. They stand for more transparency while being intransparent themselves for a good reason, actually. But how do you want to resolve it? Because it's not consistent, self-consistent.
Yeah, I don't think that this won't work. That's why we are having a different approach now. So. I do not think that it is justified to be that intransparent. And it's actually just harming everything, because it all becomes so blurry that no one understands anymore what's actually going on and what it is that is being attacked, what an organization needs to defend from. And you're just opening up more corners for attack by that approach. So I think nothing is sustainable, and that's not what, I mean, it's maybe a decision of what we want for the future. Do we want a solution to our problems that is sustainable, that can live in the sunlight as we want everyone else to be? Or do we want a solution that goes so deep into the underground that it's not really a solution, but it's more a hack, maybe? So do we want a real, properly engineered solution, or do we want a hack that some people could benefit from, but it's not really scaling to all of society? And so I think any such organization has to stick by its own by the own rules it's trying to impose. And that all the transparency is only helping in strengthening it. So I think that's the better approach, and that is why one of the reasons why we decided to leave and do things way more transparent than had been done there. So
thank you.
Sadi, it looks like I have to cut us off because we're out of time. No? Okay, I've been granted 5 more minutes.
Okay, thank you. Your open approach sounds nice, but how are you keeping the quality, and how do you avoid fake cables that floods the system?
Okay, that's so. The problem is that I haven't even talked about the approach in a way that it would give a basis for the answer for that question, I think. So, okay.
The problem might be that people who don't like the system just put in content.
Yeah, but that's primarily not a problem of the system. So you see, what will happen is basically, what WikiLeaks is it's a post-drop. You can, same as you can stuff an unsigned envelope into the mail, you can post the document online, and it has some anonymity features. And those receiving the document can take care of keeping the source of the document anonymous. Okay, so what WikiLeaks has one of these post-drops. So in the future, there will just be 100 of these post-drops, and there will be organizations or individuals responsible for taking care of what comes into that post-drop. So if that system is flooded, that's first of all their problem. So that's, I think, what every newspaper or every NGO or whoever else is working in the public interest has as a potential problem, that you just send them a lot of crap and they will not be running any stories on it just because it's not interesting. So they need to put up resources to deal with that, and in the same way they will have to put up resources to deal with what's coming in via that technology. And that's why actually the decentralization is better, because it's not just one organization now that's flooded with potentially a lot of crap, but it's actually 100-fold, and it's just distributed better. So you're avoiding bottlenecks there.
Thanks.
Yes, thank you. I praise the idea of diversity and redundancy and distributing all these input channels, but I'm curious as to how you or whoever you might know sees the risk of personal data getting leaked, because what I understand WikiLeaks have done with these cables is crossing out names, perhaps. And how do you take care of the personal data that should be secure when having hundreds of input cables?
Yeah. Okay. So that is a valid question. And again, if you look at the last three big disclosures where that exact problem would potentially should have been addressed, there were different approaches on how to solve that, and in the end it all boiled down to a question of manpower you could put into solving that issue. And that again only works by diversifying the field and pulling in more people and more resources. And that's where there's experience with a lot of organizations in doing this, and they have standards that have been set out over decades on how to do this properly, on where to draw a line between public interest and just violating someone's personal rights or whatever in that respect. So I think a decentralized approach there also helps this, because you pool all the experiences that already exist and you do not try to redefine or reinvent the wheel that is already there. So from our perspective, that is a good approach to actually hardening that process. Guido.
Okay, another question out of the chat, anonymous. There are lots of new leaks projects popping up. How can whistleblowers decide which are safe?
That is a good question. well, I mean, I can answer that for us. I think, at least because we come from the background we come from, we have some credibility there and maybe an easier start than most others. And the transparency that we plan in explaining the systems that we use and how this is all set up will also help to establish that credibility. But how other initiatives will do that, I'm not entirely sure. So There's a German newspaper that has just embarked with their own project, and it's very high level in the description, but I'm not entirely sure if that's the right approach. So on the other hand, and that's okay, I should mention that too, what we're also working on, and that will be part of OpenLeaks at its release and in the very beginning, is that we are working on a knowledge base that where we try to collect all the experiences that we make over time. So if these are technical requirements or legal requirements or different things that we experience, we feel they should be pooled into a knowledge base so that people that are trying to do something similar or even the same, wherever in the world, can just pool from these resources and can get into a dialogue and make sure that there's not a gatekeeping happening, but actually something that is causing more creative projects to happen.
Yeah, for just a comment on the last question, I think the one who delivers best for whistleblowers will be the ones used by whistleblowers. So what whistleblowers need is impact without getting hurt. So impact can be done by big mass media or by matching correctly the media and the one and the theme concerned. So we'll see. But I stood up because I wasn't too happy with your answer on the flooding issue. Mm-hmm. I think it's fine for you to say, okay, OpenLeaks will be some kind of technical letterbox at the very beginning, and it's not our business, fine. But I think it's not an answer that you distribute the flooding to even more diversity, and thus creating problems for even more NGOs and creating the same filtering problems at different places in media. So I would ask you to think about implementing in your tool a way that the community gives information about the things in the pool to each other, so that if one member of your organization or user, end user of your organization has a kind of done a check on a document, then this information should be there available for the others either to decide, okay, we trust in them or we don't trust in them, we do the check again or we don't do it.
Yeah, well, that's, okay, I have to, I guess we are at the end anyways. So what has to be clear, and that's really important because I want to make sure that there's no confusion. Whatever you think OpenLeaks will be is probably not 100% accurate yet. So just give us some more time. All these concerns that you have, and they are valid concerns, these are all addressed. It's just not something that I can elaborate on right now just because it's a really complex topic. So there are a lot of mechanisms that were built into this system to ensure that there's no gatekeeping happening and that there's mutual trust relationships that can be built up within the community, that actually there is a community building happening. And that's what's all going to be explained on the website over time in the next few weeks and months. So just give us some more time. We're in for long-term sustainability and healthy development of a project that is what we feel very important. So just give us some more time. I don't mind. I'm dying 1,000 deaths, but other than that.
Okay, another question out of the chat. You talk to Netzpolitik.org, you won't talk much about you and WikiLeaks anymore. It's past. How do you explain that you write a book called Inside WikiLeaks?
Yeah, that's a valid question too. So that's a very personal thing now. When for the last 2.5 or 3 years I've been working with that project, I think I have, especially in this community here and in Germany, more than in any other place in the world, built up a reputation for that project. So when it was clear that we had to part roads, and I was not so sure about some of the principles in the WikiLeaks project anymore, I felt I had to at least publicly say that I'm not so sure about what's going on anymore, and that's why I did this interview in Der Spiegel. And just wanted to sort of relative, make it a bit more relative how much credibility people assume, because I had delivered that to the public for 2.5 years as a speaker of that project. So I did this interview. I talked to Markus at Netzpolitik just to make sure that people understand the basis of my criticism and that they start thinking about the idea or the concept and the implementation of WikiLeaks a bit more critically. And then lots of things started to happen. I realized that there are, first of all, lots of other books that are coming out, and I have no idea what how good the basis for research in these books is, so I don't really know how they will spin a story that I think is too important to be misunderstood. There were lots of rumors that were spread by me. I mean, even Süddeutsche Zeitung here had in the magazine an article that quoted some weird allegation saying that it couldn't be ruled out that the people leaving WikiLeaks would be paid by the FBI for criticizing the organization. And all sorts of stuff like this, which was just trying to debase what we had been saying or trying to convene. So Julian was saying that I was just an ex-employee leaving the organization and that I didn't have to be taken too seriously just because people that leave organizations always are critical of their former employers. And I've never been employed by this organization. We were all people working on this collaboratively. And it's just that I felt that the whole public perception was at risk of misunderstanding these whole issues. And then there are a lot of things that happened in the past 3 years that I think people should know about to understand the story correctly. So we always said, and that was one of the basic fundamentals of WikiLeaks, is that we think the historic record and its accuracy is important. And I still stand by that definition. And part of what I have to say, I guess, is part of this historic record. And all the speculation that is going on is just speculated because there's a void of information and no one really knows what had happened and how this all works. We're back here with matters of intransparency and no one really understanding what's going on. And that's why I felt that it is important to tell that story, not just in 5 sentences that I get when some reporter asks me, but tell it in a fair way so that it is fair enough to shed light on all of that story and not just particular angles, whether this is good sides or critical sides. So that's why I decided to do that, if that answers the question. Huh? I don't think so, but no, quite unfortunately not, but then again, that was not, I mean, I'm not into that business at all, and I'm working with someone that understands the whole business of publishing books, and I'm not interested in taking care of any of that, so I will certainly make sure that whatever is happening with what is generated by that book goes to something useful, and that partly will be to make me and others independent so we can continue work on another unfunded project. And it will also hopefully, for example, contribute to the Bradley Manning supporter campaign, which is something I haven't mentioned at all either during all of that talk. I don't know, we're also distracted, you know. We're discussing other legal cases that I think are so shallow compared to one legal case where potentially there's a really courageous person that has made a change, and there's not even the support that was pledged for going to that. So this is all, I mean, I could elaborate on all these things so long, and it's just a bit frustrating to see, and I think that's why we all need to refocus a bit on the things that really matter, and to look critically and support things that are worth to be supported. So. I'm really sorry that I am so tired. I sat here until 6:30 this morning trying to work out a talk, and I think I just should have gone to bed and worked it out this morning. But I'll leave the stage next time someone starts to clap.
Last question.
Yes.
Last question, finally. Out of the chat, also a comment. But
yes.
The more people you are pulling in to process your data, the more people actually see potential personal data that shouldn't be published.
There are mechanisms for that as well. So it's a multi-layered kind of approach. We'll all make this all public, but not without a graphic or so. It's really impossible to explain. And it would just lead to some more confusion and follow-up questions. So again, I can only hope that you all give us a few more days so we can, or weeks, to put up the website that will explain it all to you. So we're looking forward to starting testing in January anyways, so that's when the first parts of the technology will go into a live test. And before that, the website will certainly be online. We'll have a great video that shows you how all of this works, and from then on, we'll have a basis for a more detailed discussion, I guess. We'll be having a very large session at the camp next year, so I can only ask everyone to come, and you'll have all the answers you want. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Daniel.